This is India, a very popular dude on the world stage. India is a huge country, with a huge population, and is considered as one of the emerging superpowers. So, how powerful is India? Well, India is already quite powerful economically, dominating the world's affairs with those economic muscles and knowledge industry. Nevertheless, there are still some challenges, including the huge wealth gap, poverty, and rampant corruption. The military strength and technology of India has some catching up to do. In other words, India is kinda there, but not really there yet. Since the 2010s, the world is heading towards a multipolar direction. The current world bullies are United States, China, and to a certain extent, Russia, and the European Union. With the rise of India, the world can expect some interesting chess play between these five players in the future, much like how these five snobs shaped Europe in the early 19th century. Currently, India is more or less aligned with the United States, because both countries are not happy by the ever-increasing Chinese encroachment. India also loves Russia, because Russia has those military equipments to satisfy India's needs. India and the European Union are friendly towards each other, because everyone loves money. India dominates the geopolitics regionally, but has yet to be able to effectively exert its influence globally, because China is there, for now at least. Looking back into history, India has always been a dominant force in the region. The Indus Valley civilization is one of the birthplace of civilizations, along with Egypt, Mesopotamia, China, Norte Chico, and Olmecs. After some droughts, migrations, and religions development, the Maurya Empire came along and dominated the Indian subcontinent. India also had some Greek kingdoms, because Alexander the Great came by, which combined the best of both Greek and Indian cultural influences. Fast forward, the Gupta Empire came along, a golden age in the Indian civilization. Indian cultural influence spread over many parts of Southeast Asia, Indianizing the crap out of everyone. Also, Buddhism, a religion from the Indian subcontinent, became popular across East Asia and Southeast Asia. India became an economic powerhouse in the ancient world through maritime trading. During the Middle Age, lots of kingdoms came and went, including this Chola dynasty who flexed its Tamil muscles in the Malay archipelago. The people in the Indian subcontinent really loved advanced mathematics. Meanwhile, in the northern parts of the Indian subcontinent, the Muslims came along for some conquests, and established a number of Muslim states over the centuries. By the way, the modern beef between Pakistan and India can trace its origins to the emergence of Muslim states in the Indian subcontinent. Some notable big bully Muslim states include the Delhi Sultanate and the Bengal Sultanate. It is noted that some kingdoms and dynasties in the Indian subcontinent can trace their origins to the Turks, Mongols, and Persians. The Hindus also had their own big bullies. Then, the Mughal Empire came along and dominated much of the Indian subcontinent. The Mughal Empire was an economic powerhouse in the early modern period, becoming the biggest global economy and manufacturing power, with a nominal gross domestic product that valued a quarter of the world's economy, larger than its contemporary European countries' economy combined. This is why the Europeans had always been very keen to find India to get some of those cash, and some Europeans even went the wrong way and discovered a whole new world, labeling those American natives as Indians. Anyway, back to legit Indians. The decline of the Mughal Empire coincided with the gradual European involvement in the Indian subcontinent. The ultimate winner is Britain, because Britain has those navy power. Anyway, Britain gained control of the Indian subcontinent, exploited the crap out of it, and making itself very rich. India was known as the crown jewel of the British Empire, a fancy term for cash cow. Unsurprisingly, the people of the Indian subcontinent were not happy being exploited, and thus demanded for independence from Britain. After World War II, they succeeded in gaining independence, carved up into separate countries. During the Cold War, India got into beefs with its neighbors, had a crush on the Soviet Union, opened up in the 1990s, experienced huge economic growth, won the 2011 Cricket World Cup, and here we are today. From history, one can conclude that India had always been a top dog. Currently, India is on its way to regain its position as the world leader. India has always been compared to China, because both countries had comparable population, had existed in various forms for thousands of years, were poor as crap during the early Cold War period, implemented closed economy before opening up to global trade which led to unprecedented economic growth. China got a head start as Mr. Deng opened up China for global trade in the late 1970s, which propelled China into a world big bully as we know it today. India, on the other hand, got a later start than China, as it opened up for full-scale global trade in the 1990s. Since then, the Indian economy has increased significantly, and now it's one of the top five economies of the world. Given the ongoing trade war between China and United States, India provides a very attractive alternative to China. India has a huge internal market, and a large number of highly skilled human resources who can speak English, and the labor cost is cheap. In other words, India is the ultimate dream for any investors. Also, the tech game of India is strong, a conducive environment for startups to grow exponentially. So what is holding India back? Well, historically it was Britain. Today, it's the underdeveloped infrastructure, lack of effective governance, and the rampant corruption. Also, India is incredibly diverse, which could pose a challenge to national unity. Unlike the Chinese dynasties, the people in India did not really have the sense of historical unity as Indians, because there were many historical kingdoms and empires in the Indian subcontinent, each with its own distinct cultures, languages, and religions. Nevertheless, despite with these challenges, India will continue to rise, unless of course if India and Pakistan decided to nuclear bomb the crap out of one another and destroy each other's economy. Is the rise of India good for the world? Well, if you love humanity, you can say that the rise of India is a good thing as it can lift millions of people out of poverty, improving everyone's social development and well-being. If you love exploiting cheap labor, then the rise of India will not be good for your investments in India due to the increased labor cost, perhaps time to look for another cheap labor country to exploit. We can be thankful to the people in India for their contribution to the human society since the ancient times, IT technical support, entertaining movies with elaborated dancing, science and technology, and many more. Can India coexist peacefully as one of the big bullies of the world? For China, probably not. For everyone else, probably yes, because everyone needs some Indian dude's help and explanation on YouTube to pass those exams. Thanks for watching.